terpana dan terdiam. Ku melihat sadarku bertahun bersama terbujurlah. Yang terindah, yang terhampar, berlalulah. Sadarku semuanya perasaan, rasa cinta. Kau yang diinginkan aku dari mimpiku, dari mimpiku. Oh, coba terbangkan hayalku dari sadarku. Semuanya perasaan, rasa cinta. Kau lah yang diinginkan aku dari mimpiku, dari mimpiku. Oh, coba terbangkan hayalku dari sadarku.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome. I hope everyone is doing well and staying healthy. My name is Afni and I'll be the MC for today's forum. Ladies and gentlemen, Foreign Policy Community of Indonesia is pleased to host a public forum with Minister of Foreign Affairs of Malaysia, His Excellency Dato Saifuddin Abdullah. Today's forum will talk about Malaysia's perspective on peaceful coexistence in ASEAN. Before we move forward, please allow me to welcome FPCI University chapters from across Indonesia who are joining us online today. We have FPCI chapter from Jakarta, Surakarta, Makassar, Medan, Semarang, Surabaya, Yogyakarta, Malang, and Purwokerto. They are all tuning in on our Zoom and YouTube channel. Welcome everyone. To start our forum, I would like to invite Ambassador Sumadi Broto Diningrat, FPCI Senior Fellow, to deliver his opening remarks. Ambassador Sumadi, the floor is yours.
Terima kasih banyak, MC. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi dan salam sejahtera bagi kita semuanya. Yang mulia, Datuk Saifuddin Abdullah, pertama-tama perkenankan saya menyampaikan selamat datang pada Yang Mulia beserta rombongan dan dengan kerendahan hati sekaligus mengucapkan selamat atas pengangkatan Datuk menjadi Menteri Luar Negeri Malaysia. Indeed, it is truly a great honor for FPCI. I started to pronounce an Indonesian abbreviation. For FPCI to play host in its office to such a distinguished dignitary from brotherly neighboring country, Malaysia. We hope that this visit will provide us with a fresh impetus for closer relationship, not only at the level of government to government, but also between independent institutions, in which the FPCI is very eager to actively participate in. Excellency, FPCI, as you have just watched in the, from the video, Foreign Policy Community of Indonesia, that was founded by our friend Dr. Dino Patti Djalal in 2014, has in a very short span of time developed to become one of the largest independent institutions focusing on international affairs in Indonesia and perhaps even in Southeast Asia, with more than 100 people in our network.
100,000?
Mostly youngsters.
100,000, not 100.
100,000. Yes.
Yes, yes, sir.
In our flagship project, we led a consortium of think tanks in convening a global town hall, the biggest premier foreign policy conference, attended by 7 foreign ministers, 3 heads of international organizations, 100 leading minds, and around 10,000 participants from 83 countries. Another successful program of FPCI is public discussion, featuring prominent speakers on subject or topics of great interest to the public, and so much so that we dare to take initiative to add to this program, to the already rich and well-planned agenda of yours, Minister. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, my friends, the students, today we are fortunate to be able to organize an important public discussion on a subject of utmost relevance, ASEAN. ASEAN, with its current internal situations, its unity, its community building, its internal problems, but also its centrality, its role and initiative in shaping regional geopolitical and geoeconomic dynamics and cooperation, as well as external challenges, and all they will be viewed from the perspective of Malaysia. To address these issues and to articulate Malaysian perspective, there cannot be another person more appropriate and more authoritative than the Malaysian Foreign Minister in person. We are truly, we are trying to design the format as lively as possible, whereby our chairman, whereby the Minister, Dato Saifuddin, will express his views in a direct conversation with our chairman, Dino Patti Djalal, who is currently in Los Angeles. Of course, audience will also have the opportunity to raise questions depending on our time available or the time available to us. I know that all of us is getting impatient to listen to our distinguished guest speaker. Therefore, I shall just close my opening remark here. But before giving back the floor to the MC, I still have to fulfill a very pleasant duty to introduce senior FPCI personality here present, which is Ambassador Iwan Widanata Maja, Senior Fellow, and Bapak Doni Agustiadi, Advisor to the FPCI. So I would like to give back the microphone to the MC to start the real discussion. Please.
Thank you, Ambassador, for your remarks. Now, without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Dino Patti Djalal, Founder and Chairman of Foreign Policy Community of Indonesia, to moderate the discussion. Dr. Dino, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Afni. Thank you, Ambassador Sumadi. And welcome, Foreign Minister Saifuddin Abdullah. And we are really happy to have you. You know, when they told me that you're going to do this interview with the FPCI, I knew I was going to be in Los Angeles, and I said to FPCI Secretariat, no matter what time and where I am, I have to be there to honor and host, do the moderating for your interview. So really, it's a great honor for us to have you. And also, you should feel at home, Foreign Minister, because we have so many things in common. You know, I feel really connected to you. One is you are very much into youth. Yeah, you did so many things on the youth. You were the president of Malaysian Youth Council, and you are a member of the UN Secretary General High Panel on Youth Employment, right? So that's one. And secondly, you're into basketball, right? I used to be a basketball fanatic, right? In fact, I used to be a towel boy for a basketball team in my college in New York, right? And my son now is on the basketball team in the school in Jakarta. You're also a progressive. We at FPCI, we love progressive people who think outside the box, who are creative and reformist. And lastly, you are an activist, our kind of people, because activists are always pushing the boundaries, taking risks, creating progress, making changes that are necessary, and always energetic. So you really are kind of people, Foreign Minister. And before I begin the question and answer, I want to begin with a Malaysian tradition of pantun. But keep in mind, I'm very amateur at this, so please don't forgive me if I'm not as good as Malaysians in pantun. Yesterday, I went to Banjarmasin to get some fruit at floating market. Today, we are happy to welcome Dato Saifuddin. Please enjoy your time at FPCI Secretariat. So many cars in the highway. Going so fast like a thunder. Although I'm far away, holding you at FPCI is a great honor. I got to take lessons from you on how to do a pantun the proper way, right? But Foreign Minister, let me begin with the first question. Have been a key architect in Malaysian foreign policy, especially the foreign policy framework of the new Malaysia. Yeah. And can you give us a summary? What are Malaysia's foreign policy outlook and perspectives under your leadership?
Well, assalamualaikum and good morning. I must first of all thank you, Pak Dino, for the invitation. I like your pantun. I'm not so sure I can actually buy. They say menjual pantun, you sell, so you sold. And they will expect me to beli, to buy. So I can just give you dua baris pantun. Yeah. Merisik kekasih dalam kenangan. Terima kasih atas undangan. I hope I did quite well. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, I'm really honored to be here, Pak Ambassador, teman-teman, and students. My only complaint, Dr. Dino, Pak Dino, when I first came to your studio, I see so many young people. Then I realized that I'm not that young anymore.
You're young at heart.
Well, I first became foreign minister in 2018, and it was a new government at that time. For the first time ever, Malaysia has a genuine change of guard in terms of a new prime minister, a new cabinet, and a new government led by a new party altogether. And at that point in time, I thought it is important that we put our foreign policy in writing so that people understand. And true enough, one of the first things that I have to do whenever I see new friends who are foreign ministers or when I attend international functions is, what is the current foreign policy of Malaysia? So that publication that you quoted, that you were referring to, the Foreign Policy Framework of New Malaysia, which was, as I said, published in 2018, was to show three things. Number one, that the foreign policy, the fundamentals remain consistent, remain the same. For example, Indonesia, we take Indonesia as top of the agenda. No foreign minister and no prime minister from Malaysia will go out of Malaysia for their first trip, but must be Jakarta. ASEAN remains the cornerstone of our foreign policy. We remain independent, neutral. We believe in multilateralism. We continue speaking for the oppressed, for the mustadafin, and so on and so forth. But there would be some new focus, because it's a new government led by a new party with some kind of a different ideology from the former National Front government. Then I came back this time, it's a new government again, but this is a continuation of the government that came into place in 2018 with some major changes 22 months later. So we are actually now completing a new framework, but this time it is more to look at what do we do in the next, now and the next few years in the context of post-COVID-19 pandemic. So again, we repeat the point that the fundamentals remain the same, but there are new priorities, and there are at least six new priorities. Of course, the main theme is reopening of the economy, which is the main agenda. But we are now talking about health diplomacy, cultural diplomacy, something that we can learn a lot from Indonesia. Cybersecurity is becoming the most important non-traditional threat. Digital economy as a new emphasis within the realm of economic diplomacy, which the fundamentals remain the same. We have to celebrate the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, and a few weeks ago, Prime Minister Ismail Sabri presented the 12th Malaysia plan, and the SDGs, the 17 goals of the SDGs are embedded in the 12th Malaysia plan. And last but not least, number six is peaceful coexistence as a concept that we would like to offer to the world community as our discourse within the realm of multilateralism, which I think many people are now celebrating in a high spirit after the change of guard in the White House recently.
Okay, thank you. You know, Foreign Minister, Indonesia these days describes itself as a middle power. And some countries describe themselves as a great power, a superpower, or major power. Malaysia, how would you describe yourself, your country, in terms of that classification? Middle power, or what would it be? Yeah. Or you don't have a classification? Yeah.
How I wish we can define our foreign policy and position Malaysia as a middle power. But we have had a lot of debate back home on whether actually pronouncing Malaysia's position as a middle power is really a strategic thing. So you won't see that in our coming framework. But yes, we would like to play a more proactive role. And I underline the word proactive to differentiate with Qatar's hyperactive. Qatar,
yes.
A small country, but they position themselves as playing a hyperactive role in the region and in the international community. We would like to say that we are a moderate power. We define ourselves in three words. We are multicultural, we are modern, and we are progressive. Of course, there is the underlying what you call virtues or values where Malaysia is rich with Malay Islamic tradition and heritage.
Thank you. By the way, Dato, I hope you don't mind if we switch our talk in English, because I'm getting a message that there are quite plenty of diplomatic corps that are listening, and a lot of our audience, actually, they all understand and speak English anyways. Yeah. So let's switch language. You mentioned about peaceful coexistence. Now, I want to link this to the fact that for Western countries, and especially United States, the question of values is very important for their foreign policy. Foreign policy is about advancing certain values that they believe to be universal, right? You know, in the context of what you said about peaceful coexistence and the context of ASEAN, right, how important are values in your view, in Malaysia's foreign policy, and in terms of how ASEAN should relate to other powers?
I think we place values as something that is considered a premium. You have to have some values as your guiding principles. You have to have a certain for lack of better expression, you have to have some kind of idealism within you. I'm not referring to ideology as in the normal political discourse, but idealism as in a set of belief that, for example, I'm sure in your foreign policy, you have some reason why you want to consider and pronounce your positioning as a middle power. There must be something behind it, and some values that you base your positioning. Now, in the context of foreign policy, I think we subscribe to the notion that we have to love thy neighbor, which is an Islamic value, which is also a Christian value, and I think a value that is embraced by all believers, no matter what religion or what faith you or one believes in. For peaceful coexistence, the crux of the concept lies in one specific verse of the Quran, which is Al-Hujurat, verse number 13, Lita'arafu, to know each other. It's quite a long verse, but the main term is Lita'arafu, to know each other. To know each other in the meaning that you celebrate the other, which is very important. And we learn this through being a multicultural society, that if you are seated with people from different ethnic, different language, different culture, and different religion in a room, there is this theory called the empty chair next to you. There's someone seated beside you, but you consider it empty because you don't know the other, you don't love the other. So Lita'arafu is about knowing and celebrating the presence of the other, recognizing her differences with you, but you cherish it and you want to know better and you want to work in harmony and not to despise her or her presence. Because the problem is, there are people who think and wish, even in the year 2021, how I wish God would have created one, only one, one race or one ethnic and one religion. But God says in the Quran that, you know, if He will, He would want to do that, but He didn't. And this is where Al-Hujurat verse 13 come into being, be relevant. That God actually created men and women, different tribe, different race, you know, for them to know each other, not to despise each other, to work, to celebrate the presence of other. And that is, to me, what multilateralism is all about. You yes. have to upscale the discussion, the discourse, from the other who is seated besides you, the others who are seated in your room, the rest of the citizens who are, you know, citizens of your country, to your neighbor, to and you then substitute men and women and the tribes to different nations, different countries, different regions, and become, as we all are celebrating, you know, we, the people of the United Nations.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I like your emphasis on people, on peaceful coexistence. Unfortunately, that is not being practiced by United States and China, where it's not peaceful coexistence, but more competitive zero-sum rivalry marked by increasing strategic distrust. So my question to you is, obviously, everyone else is feeling the heat and pull of these geopolitical rivalries between the two giants, United States and China. How does Malaysia position herself in this tightening geopolitical competition?
Well, there is this saying that when America sneezes, we all catch fewer.
Yes.
I'm not sure if we have a similar, you know, saying for China, but yes, we feel the heat, but we want to maintain our neutrality. We want to be friends of all, including the five superpowers. We try to impress upon both Beijing and DC that we are friendly to each other. Before I came to this ministry again, I was in charge of, I was at the Ministry of Telecommunication and Multimedia. There I saw firsthand the contestation to the extent of like to the war, the technological war, how DC is so mad against, for example, Huawei technology. And there are lots of Huawei technology in Malaysia. Almost all telcos in Malaysia use Huawei technology. Now, but there is another concept in international relations called hedging. You remain neutral, but you are free to do what you like with whichever country you feel comfortable with, as in business, as in sending your children to study. For further education and so on. So I don't think we have compromised our principles of neutrality if almost all of Malaysian telco companies are using Huawei technology. And I think in this context, I hope that DC will understand. It does not mean that because Malaysian telcos, most of them are using Chinese technology, then we are somehow inclined to China, not at all.
But now, isn't it a big challenge for ASEAN to maintain its centrality, not just maintain, but to furnish its centrality in the midst of a very fluid geopolitical situation? Do you think that ASEAN's ability to maintain its centrality is is more challenging and more difficult than ever, given the present situation?
Well, I think ASEAN, to a lot of extent, has done quite well to maintain its centrality and was able to consensusly agree to many of the big decisions that they have to make, except the last one with Myanmar. There was no consensus. We can revisit that topic after this. But there are, I think, incidences once in a while when we may be facing new issues. Well, for some countries, the AUKUS incident, well, announcement rather, was worrying. I think Malaysia expressed our concern in the strongest of words, but still maintaining our, you know, arrangement with Australia, including the five defense arrangement. Yeah, we, Mary Spain, the foreign minister, spoke to me twice on the phone immediately after the announcement, and also last week after they sent their vice admiral to brief us on what that submarine is all about. She tried her level best, and her team tried their level best to impress upon us that it is a nuclear propelled submarine, but not a nuclear armed submarine. We take it at face value that that's what it is, because it is still a work in progress. But we were very clear about sending our message of concern to Canberra. Now, the South China Sea remain.
Do you mind if I go back to the AUKUS foreign minister? Just to clarify, what is the basis of Malaysia's concern or caution about AUKUS, as you underlined?
There are two things, both for Malaysia and also for ASEAN. We believe in the, fundamental of the ZOPFN that we hold on to very strongly, zone of peace, freedom and neutrality. We also have our own declaration making our region as a region that is free from nuclear power. I think we all want the Straits of Malacca, Sulawesi Sea and South China Sea to be a zone of peace for people to travel freely to do trade and business, rather than having warships traveling. But we are all subscribers to UNCLOS, the United Nations Law of the Seas, where people have free navigation and free overflight in the international waters. So yes, we need to balance that. But nuclear power is not something that will make Malaysians, and I believe many ASEAN people, comfortable to live with. We know the difference between nuclear arm and using nuclear for scientific purposes. But again, I think, when I talk to my friends, they always remind me, they say, "Din, it is a submarine. Whether it is nuclear propelled and not nuclear arm, it is a submarine. What do you use submarine for?" So there remain the concern.
Are you worried, Dato, that the region is, especially Southeast Asia, is heading towards geostrategic condensation, where there are just going to be more boats, more guns, more submarines, more capabilities, more modernization, and not balanced with more trust, not balanced with more confidence building measures. And in the end, you know, it's going to be a very complicated place, our region. Do you see that as something worrying you?
Well, I hope it is not going to happen, at least not in the near future. But should we be concerned about it? I think we should. And there are at least two ways of looking at it. On the one hand is the military rivalry per se of superpowers who have interest in the region, who have their fleet roaming South China Sea especially. And I'm sure you remember, I think 2 or 3 years ago, two war naval ships belonging to two superpowers. They were in the South China Sea and they were just about 150 meters away. For a car that we drive 150 meters away is okay, but for two big battleships 150 meters away is not something that you want to be in. Well, luckily there was no incidents. And we know for a fact that with our course, and there is a possibility that some other powers will try to show their presence. On the other hand, when there are certain events take place that requires ASEAN as a whole to make important decisions. For instance, Myanmar, the current situation.
Yes.
You will also see the same powers making phone calls to foreign ministers and so on, trying to send signals as to the kind of outcome that they would want to be made. But I must underline the fact that I think foreign ministers, as diplomats, we receive all kinds of phone calls. But in the context of the most recent decision on Myanmar, we were very sure that we were making our decisions based on our independent study of the case, and we made our decision based on our own perspective. Not saying that the phone calls are not important, but I'm simply sharing the fact that there is the military rivalry per se, and it gets into more complication because sometimes the same powers are also interested in some other affairs relating to ASEAN.
Well, talking about Myanmar, how disappointed have you been in terms of the progress by ASEAN to help alleviate the situation there? I think there were some expectations, some plans, some trips, maybe even some kind of roadmap. But we don't seem to be making much mileage. So how hopeful or disappointed are you now?
I would say very disappointed. Mm-hmm. And this is something that is shared by a few other foreign ministers, which of course I'm not supposed to mention who. I'm sure you can guess. You see, in April this year, our leaders met, and after a thorough discussion, they came up with two very important decisions. Number one, the 5-point consensus. Number two, to appoint Dato Irwan, the second foreign minister of Brunei Darussalam. Brunei is now chair of ASEAN. Appointed him as ASEAN chair special envoy to Myanmar. And Dato Irwan is supposed to visit Myanmar. He had several discussions with the foreign minister of the junta, and unfortunately he until the end, until last Friday when we had our emergency meeting of foreign ministers, and Irwan invited the foreign minister of Myanmar, and he was there present. We had a very candid discussion, very frank discussion, like, you know, ASEAN brothers and sister. But we were disappointed because on the one hand, Myanmar was very late in facilitating or try to facilitate Irwan's visit to Myanmar. Number two, even at the last minute when Irwan was supposed to go to Myanmar, then they add some prerequisites or new points. For example, Irwan is supposed to see all stakeholders, and Malaysia put our stand very clearly from the start, I mean from at least a month ago, that Irwan must be allowed to meet with Aung San Suu Kyi, among others. And there's no compromise for that. And they don't allow Irwan to see Aung San Suu Kyi or the other leaders of the NUG or NLD. So that was the reason that I think Irwan gave a deadline of 14 October for his last date to go. And then there was supposed to be another deadline, 18th to 20th of this month. But then again, Irwan was not given, was not guaranteed that he will be given access to meet all stakeholders as agreed by the junta senior general in April this year.
Yeah. Well, you know, I do agree that, and you know, FPCI did an NGO summit on Myanmar, and we were very concerned about one, the fact that the military government is not living up to its moral and political commitment to the ASEAN Charter, and is not treating Aung San Suu Kyi and her colleagues in a fair way, in a way that respects her and their human rights. So I think that's something that is very concerning for us, and I hope there will be some progress on that. I want to state on that, Foreign Minister, that during the Suharto days, when he had the issue with East Timor, and Sanana Gusmao was in jail, even then, Indonesia, which was under authoritarian government, allowed almost everybody to visit Sanana Gusmao in jail, right, in the hopes of finding a resolution, right. So I think the response of the military government to not allow the special envoy to meet all the stakeholders are. Really something of grave concern, right? But I want to ask your thoughts on the question of non-interference. Yeah? As you know, this is a sacred principle in ASEAN, and discussions on Myanmar always has that issue at the back of everyone's head, right? So what does that mean when we address the issues of Myanmar in terms of the relevance of non-interference? To what extent is non-interference observed? Or to what extent this is not a non-interference issue in ASEAN?
There are two things here, Pak Dino. Number one, in our case, non-interference should not be used as a shield or as an excuse for outside influencers or outside actors to not even speak about certain issues that is happening within a specific state. I think we are living in a globalized world. No land is an island, no country is an island. You are open to comments, you are open to criticisms. So as a Democrat, I think we should respect that people can have differences in opinions. There can be contestation of ideas, and we can differ, we can rebut. But I don't think your rebuttal should be, oh, please do not interfere into our affairs. Not is that is a very covert position. It's not intellectual at all. Neither it is something that is sensible. So I don't buy the argument that ASEAN member states or the nine ASEAN member states are interfering in Myanmar, unless you don't understand English. Number two, what happens to one of our member state has impact on the rest of ASEAN. So we have to look at it in a brotherly manner, that we are trying to assist and facilitate. And we made it very clear in the last meeting on Friday that none of us have the, the faintest idea to moot an argument that we should exclude Myanmar from the summit. And that was the reason why, even though there was no consensus, the chair then, make the decision or make the conclusion that because there was no consensus, so ASEAN is not inviting the senior general, the head of the military administration in Myanmar, but we want to invite a non-political representation from Myanmar.
Okay. By the way, before I read some questions from Jakarta Post and other students, I want to ask you one other question on Quad. Yeah. And as you know, Quad has become a presence in Indo-Pacific, and Quad has elevated their game. Now it's at the leaders level and has become more coordinated. I just want to get your reflection on Quad and ASEAN. Yeah, what should be the relationship, if at all, between ASEAN and Quad? How should ASEAN see Quad?
Please. We have
Quad, for those who are new to international affairs, Quad is a grouping, informal grouping between the United States, Australia, Japan, and India, right? And they're both focused on the Indo-Pacific.
Yeah.
Please, Foreign Minister.
On this point, I must give credit to Ibu Retno and the Indonesia for leading the charge on behalf of ASEAN to bring the discourse or the Indo-Pacific discourse to ASEAN. And we crafted our own perspective, our own version of the Indo-Pacific idea. So we came up with a document called the ASEAN Outlook on the Indo-Pacific idea. And I think we have shared this with the Quad and also others, because as again, you know, our region is like a beautiful girl sorted by so many gentlemen, some not so handsome. yes, I think, let me put it this way. We need to continue the discourse. And this is something that I stressed when I visited ASEAN Secretariat yesterday and spoke to the permanent representative of all ASEAN member states. In many cases, instances in the past, ASEAN didn't actually play a leading role in many of the international debates or discourse. We tend to come into the discourse or the process at a very late stage. I always remind my team in Malaysia that by the time a paper is presented, either in the form of a resolution or a conference is organized by certain countries with or without the auspices of the United Nations and what have you, by the time it reached that level and you are there for the first time, you are already late. Most of the discourses has taken place 5, 7 or perhaps 10 years ago through track 1, track 1.5, track 2 channels, through, you know, think tanks and NGOs and what have you. So we have to be very, very proactive. So I think ASEAN has to remain in the discourse, in the debate. Otherwise, we would be left behind. And people may then, equate our region or draw some new lines. And suddenly, the Pacific Ocean, literally, or in the minds of others, is overstretched to influence certain part of our region. So we need to remain in the discourse.
Okay, just one last question for me. I'm being rakus by Menteri, because I really think this is a fascinating discussion. There are views that ASEAN is good in non-setting, you know, the Treaty of Amity Cooperation, ZOFAN, ASEAN Declaration, ASEAN Charter, and ASEAN is very good at convening different powers to come to the table. But at the same time, when it comes to hard power, ASEAN looks like its hands are tied. Yeah. Do you feel that when dealing with all this, right? That on hard power, especially, ASEAN can't do much. Yeah.
I think at this moment in time, ASEAN lacks leadership. I'm not talking about strong personalities. We used to have quite a number. But what I'm referring to is the leaders of ASEAN need to work together very, very closely. Remember, there was a time when our leaders were just a phone call away with the other. Though this is also happening now, but I'm not so sure if our leaders are on first name calling basis as some of them used to be in the past. So it's about collective leadership of our leaders so that they can discuss things very quickly. And sometimes you do not necessarily have to follow the usual process, you know, as some or foreign minister and then go to the leader. You waste a lot of time. Now, I appreciate the process in normal circumstances, but in times of emergency, I think we should let our leaders just call each other, speak candidly and frankly on the telephone, on secure line, of course, and make quick decisions. I think we need that kind of leadership. There was a time when ASEAN has that collective leadership and were able to make decision very quickly.
Yeah, thank you for that candor. And I agree with you. And I think especially it's important to do so because most of ASEAN leaders don't play golf anymore, right? So the phone call always helps. I'm going to take some questions from journalists. Dian Saktiari from Jakarta Post. Do you think ASEAN should have a unified voice by way of joint statement or such to respond to AUKUS?
Some countries, some member states of ASEAN has made public statements. Malaysia made 3 public statements. First, the Prime Minister, then my statement, and then the statement of Dato' Hisham, Minister of Defence and former Foreign Minister. I don't think it is really something that is that urgent for us to come up with a joint statement on AUKUS. I believe for those of us who have made our stand very clear, I guess the AUKUS partnership has listened to our complaints, if you like. Yeah.
Next question from South China Morning Post, from Amy Chu. Malaysia summoned the Chinese ambassador twice this year, in June when 16 Chinese military aircraft neared Malaysian airspace, and in October when Chinese ships were spotted in the waters of Sabah and Sarawak. Is Malaysia seeing an increase in Chinese intrusion in its waters and airspace, and why do you think so? And how worried is Malaysia over these intrusions?
China has declared the nine dash line, claiming the whole of South China Sea belonging to them. We have, I think, all claimants to whichever areas within the South China Sea has, you know, of course, protested. You know, the Chinese Coast Guard boats frequently come to our waters, especially in the area near Sarawak, particularly near a place called Beting Patinggi Ali. And we have always protested. I have lost count the number of protest notes that we send to China. But most recently, China seems to be more interested in our waters because Petronas is doing some work at a place called Kasavari. And it is the right of Petronas, it is the right of Malaysia to do this project because we are doing it within our waters and we are a sovereign country. But when China starts sending their naval ship near the area, then we thought the most appropriate response is to call or to summon the ambassador to our ministry to send our notes and so on. I think for as long as Petronas is working on Kasavari, we can expect China to be to be visiting that area perhaps more often, and we will be steadfast and continue to respond diplomatically to them. But at the same time, I have told Petronas President, you have all the right in the world to continue with your work.
Well, you know, I want to follow up on that because we noticed that in recent years, Malaysia's relations with China have been continuously recalibrated, right? Especially between a succession of prime ministers, right? So where is it now, that relation? And has it been recalibrated again?
You see, this is interesting. There was a lot of MOUs and especially business agreements and business projects in Malaysia that was agreed upon during the time of Prime Minister Najib Razak. And then we have a change of government, a totally different government altogether. And Dr. Mahathir became Prime Minister. And there was an immediate cancellation of two big projects. But Malaysia remained supportive of President Xi Jinping's BRI. And within a period of 4 months into his administration, Tun Mahathir visited China twice. One on a bilateral relation visit, and second to attend the BRI conference. And we make it very clear that China remain as our most important and the biggest trading partner, and which we want to continue doing that. We made it very clear that we remain friends with Beijing, and we celebrated our 45th anniversary of normalization of relations last year or 2 years ago, but not so much of celebration because of the COVID pandemic. And we explained our case as to why there was a cancellation of the project. But I think I take it that Beijing understand our position. They actually responded positively to our request that they buy more palm oil, and they did buy more palm oil during Mahathir's administration. Then we have another. Then we pass the baton, another change of guard, pass the baton. Now we have revisited one of the two projects that was cancelled, and this is the East-West Highway, the ECRL. So that project, which was cancelled during Mahathir's administration, is now back on track, and very soon the project will take off. So I would like to think that our relations with Beijing it's very difficult to quantify, but I think it's much better now.
Yeah. Despite
what happened in South China Sea.
Yes, maybe the best way to describe it is that Malaysia, just like Indonesia, has a rich, multi-layered and nuanced complex relationship with China, right? So you know, maybe that's a good way of looking at it. Now I want to take a question from Antara, from Arya, Antara News Agency. What are your thoughts on ASEAN's decision not to involve Myanmar junta at the ASEAN summit? And then there's one question from the Australian, from Chandi Vasandani. Is Malaysia satisfied with the explanation given by Australia by Foreign Minister Maurice Payne and Vice Admiral regarding AUKUS? Will Malaysia raise the issue of Australia acquiring nuclear-powered subs in the next NPT review? Yeah. So those two questions.
Okay. On Myanmar, I think the first one.
Yes. What are your thoughts on ASEAN's decision not to involve the Myanmar junta at the ASEAN summit?
Yes. If I can just continue from my earlier intervention on this point, is that you see, we don't question how a member state choose to govern itself. It is their sovereign right to do so. But in the context of Myanmar, the point is they are not cooperating for ASEAN to fulfill its obligation as a coalition of states. That's the main point. And that was the reason why we decided that we should come to that decision. Because otherwise, people will be questioning us. Our credibility is at stake. And it would be an embarrassment to His Majesty, the Sultan of Brunei, as chair of ASEAN, that his special envoy is treated in such ways. And I think it is only proper that we come to that kind of decision. It is not a punishment. It is really about maintaining the integrity and the credibility of the 9 ASEAN leaders who has come a long way to decide on the 5-point consensus in April. And also to be fair to Irwan, the special envoy, who has tried in many ways and has done what is humanly possible to carry out his mandate. So we need to make that decision.
Okay. And the question of AUKUS, yes.
There is during the summit there will be the the you know the during the next ASEAN summit there is the ASEAN Australia summit concurrently. Well, I believe some member states will raise the issue again. I don't think it is useful to see whether or to evaluate whether we are satisfied with the explanation. The issue is still there. It is still work in progress. We probably have to revisit it at some point. But yes, I believe some member states may want to raise the issue with Australia during the summit.
Okay, well, thank you very much for those very candid answers. I have two questions that are most difficult for you to answer, and if you can't answer them, please just say so. It's totally fine. One, you're basketball fans, I am too. Imagine young LeBron James in his prime plays one-on-one with young Michael Jordan in his prime, 10-point game. Who would win and what would be the score? One-on-one, LeBron James against Michael Jordan in their prime.
Michael Jordan, 7-3.
Okay, all right. Okay, that's very interesting. Okay, second question, this is even more sensitive. I know you're politicians, you know, you can't pick sides and show preference, but you know, I go to Kuala Lumpur and I want to search the best nasi lemak in the world. And I go to your house and I say, Dato, let's go find the best nasi lemak in the world. Where will you take me?
I will take you to Kampung Baru for nasi lemak antarabangsa.
Okay, is that a promise?
Yes.
All right.
And durian too.
All right, deal. Okay, well, we've come to the end, Dato. And to be honest, you've given us more than we bargained for. You know, you gave us a lot of insights, rich analysis, and honest, candid views about Malaysia's foreign policy, about ASEAN, about the geopolitical situation, about Myanmar. We really appreciate it. And please know that FPCI is a friend of Malaysia, and anytime that you know, we can be of assistance, we'll be happy to do so. And you will always be a friend of FPCI, and FPCI's big family. Thank you very much, Dato, for your service and for your friendship. And I would like to close with a pantun. Again, this is very amateurish, right, for me. Going on a road trip by a bus. Found a little paradise in Nusa Penida. Thank you for being here with us. Safe journey back to Malaysia. Eating raw fish in Bunaken. Never forget to get a clapper tart. Thank you for the fruitful discussion. I say goodbye and see you later.
Can I buy that pantun? Yeah, AAIOU. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Afni?
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Dino. Please give a round of applause or your virtual reactions for our moderator and speaker for the fruitful discussion. Now we have come to the end of the public forum, a conversation with Minister of Foreign Affairs of Malaysia, His Excellency Dato Saifuddin Abdullah. We would like to extend our gratitude to the Embassy of Malaysia in Jakarta for co-hosting this forum. We also would like to thank all participants for joining us and your participation today. On behalf of the organizing committee, we thank you and wish everybody to stay healthy. See you again at our future events and have a pleasant day. Thank you, everyone.